everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we're going to do part 3 of the May Garden Tour. We did 1 and 2 yesterday, but it got so cold and windy that we had to stop for the day, and today it's sunny, but it's still windy.
And so, it's going to be raining shortly.
Again, yes. Yeah. So it's just been cold and rainy and windy, and we're ready for some settled, warm, sunny 70s. That would be nice. Maybe some of you remember last year in May when it was 90, we redid this iris bed. It had been taken over by the creeping buttercups that Rick loves so much, but it was invading all the iris. When we took the iris out, we were able to separate some, and we have a beautiful iris garden now, almost ready to bloom. These again are the purple bearded iris that smell like grape Kool-Aid. They are so lovely and wonderful, and they seem to be doing really well. I don't know how many of them will actually bloom this year, but by the healthiness of them, for sure next year all of them will bloom. We also found that we had hostas in here that we couldn't even see because of that creeping buttercup. We put in a dark brown mulch that seemed to hold its place really well. We didn't want mulch around the iris, but we needed it for around the hostas and around the tree just to keep that creeping buttercup under control. We also have had to fence in a couple of the hostas only because the deer have been nibbling on them.
Well, I don't think we put any mill organite over there.
No, and that's something we're going to have to do.
One of our viewers this morning had asked, you know, what was that product that we use? Well, mill organite is a Milwaukee-based product, a bioproduct that they refine, and it's mainly used for lawns and bushes and even flower beds. But
it says you can put it on your vegetable garden, yeah. But we just stick to the flower beds and the lawn. And it really does seem to keep the deer from nibbling on things like daylilies and our tulips. We didn't have any problem with our tulips as soon as we put that on. Also, I think we have less slugs this year because all last summer you used it for fertilizer on the lawn.
Yep.
So we're seeing good effects from it. So this area we think now is done for the time being. It's under our little leaf linden, but it gets sunlight because it faces the south. So it'll get enough sun and enough moisture. They don't like to be wet. The bearded irises like their feet dry, so being on a little slope, they should be very happy.
And that's another thing too. If somebody's new to planting irises, what advice would you give them?
Well, especially for the bearded ones, they do not like to have their feet wet. They like to have, even if you have part of the rhizome above the ground, just as long as the roots are covered, they're happy. So get the roots in there and then just, you know, periodically pull away any old leaves that seem to be turning a color that you don't like, and do not throw them back into the bed itself. You need to compost this far away, or just keep it away from where the iris are. They're kind of susceptible to borers, yes, and there's a rot, iris rotting. So keep your iris beds as clean as possible. And don't mulch them heavily. You see, we have very little mulch here except along the very edge. When this area was a little bit more wild, we had this hibiscus bush here. I think it's a Rose of Sharon hibiscus, and it was kind of overgrown, and we didn't know if it was going to make it or not. We chopped it way back, and it is now coming up from the bottom, so that's a good sign, and I think it'll be very pretty there. Mm-hmm. It kind of leads through our pathway that we left to get into the garden that way. And these plants were here. This has their own like three sisters thing going on with the sedum and the lungwort, and those are, I want to say they're Stella Dora lilies. They look like those. A hosta, some old daffodils that are done, more lungwort. And then this is Burrow's Tail. This is a succulent. It has a little bit different kind of leaf on it. This part of the plant will stay green all winter under the snow, because we throw a lot of snow over here. And if it does thaw out, you'll see it's still green. These are the flowers that they have. They bloom now. They stay green a little bit longer. The hotter part of the summer, they kind of go dormant. And then again before fall, they turn green again. And they're an interesting plant. They have a different form from our normal plants.
Now, how far back are you going to deadhead the...
I will take, for a daffodil, I'll go down as far as I can, because this is a little more firm than the leaf itself. And then I'll leave the leaves on there until they are yellow. And
so just the stalks, the flower stalks, you'll take down that far. Not the leaves themselves.
No, the leaves stay there until they are totally yellow and dry. Okay.
And if you don't deadhead?
Well, if you don't deadhead, they're going to try to go, you know, this one probably wouldn't because it doesn't have, I don't think it was pollinated. But you'll find several of them are already forming seed heads. And I guess if you want to save the seeds from them, you would let them do that. But I like to have the energy of their growth go back into the bulb itself so that the bulbs get bigger and healthier. It's like the bulbs are kind of like a battery. And the sun is charging up those batteries right now for next spring. It's just always fun to walk along the side of the driveway and see what's coming up. We've put some things in here, we move things, and then other things move themselves. This we put in, this is called Shooting Star, and it'll have the neatest, tiniest little blue flowers on it. They do look like little shooting stars, but if you don't look closely, you'll miss them. And then you won't see them all summer. It'll just look like a healthy green clump of grass, but they're not grass. Daisies, I planted 1 year, and the daisies come up every year in different places. I love them. They're easy to pull out if I don't love them where they are, and I will leave the heads on so they reseed themselves and come up someplace else.
I remember 1 year, you probably had at least 100 clusters all over the place.
Oh, they were everywhere, yes.
I mean, it was kind of funny.
It was. Columbine. This is the sunny side of the driveway, and yet here we have hosta and maple tree that's trying to come out. More daisies over here, more Burrow's Tail. In here we had wormwood. Wormwood is a bush. It's kind of like an herb. It has an herby smell to it when you rub it. We liked it because it was variegated, it was a healthy bush, but it also was very invasive. So unfortunately, we tried to get rid of it by digging it out, and that didn't work totally. So we had to resort to meaner means.
Well, this is area number 3 that we're going to be reworking. This is on our to-do list, but number 3.
Number 3, because these were some lilies that were given to us, and they're interesting colors. They're kind of maroons and oranges, but either there was grass here when we planted them, or there were grass with them because we got them in clumps from a friend of ours. And so the grass has now taken over in here, so we have to clean this area up.
Well, how about your apple trees?
Now the apple trees, these are Macintosh. We're doing an espalier, meaning we're keeping them flat. And so we're gonna trim off any branches that come off the sides. We don't want them to have sides. We're going up and flat-wise.
Oh, parallel to the street.
Correct.
Why is that?
Well, because when we pull out of the driveway, we have to be able to see if traffic is coming. So we thought if we did it this way, it would be easier for us. And also, They look very healthy, but they're not ready yet to blossom. We didn't get any blossoms on them this spring. We don't know if it was the weather or if it's the maturity of the plant. Last year, I think this one had maybe two or three apples,
mm-hmm. Right.
The other one didn't have any.
It had one large one.
Right. Now, Rick put these here so that the kids, when they're walking to the high school or when they're riding their bikes down to the park, if they get hungry, they could eat an apple. Now, you may be wondering what project number two is going to be after we get the triangle done where the free library will be. This is area number two. This is where our raspberry jungle was last year. It was probably 25 by 25 full.
Square foot.
Full of raspberries. It was truly a jungle. We stopped picking after 90 quarts and we invited friends and neighbors and pulled people off the street to pick raspberries because we didn't want them to go to waste. So we pulled out as many as we possibly could. We wanted to start over and try to keep some semblance of order over here. We also had our neighbors drop off their mulched leaves and their grass clippings because we have a terrible thistle problem in this area. And we're trying to get that under control. We're using the mulch, we've used plastic. And sometimes, unfortunately, you do have to revert to
chemical warfare
thing for that particular problem.
Well, I think I've got them under control as best I can at this point.
Good. I'm glad. So. But we're going to flatten this out a little bit. Our raspberries are not disappearing, though. Every little green plant you see is a raspberry. Or more than one.
Well, we thought we'd round up maybe about two or three dozen to put into our raspberry bed area, but
right.
Now I'm looking out here and you probably have about 60 other plants at uh-huh. least that are popping up out of the ground, so we're gonna have to dig all of these up. And
we will. Well, we're gonna try to keep an area over there that's more under control. None of these will be bearing fruit this year. This is new growth, so we won't get any fruit until next year. That's okay because I still have raspberry jam and frozen raspberries in the freezer, so we'll make it. It'll be tough, but we'll be able
to
make it.
Well, these benches were hidden inside
yes,
the raspberry jungle.
In fact, they were over there, and we were standing on them to try to pick things. It was an amazing season.
Jungle.
Yes.
In fact, they were really almost into our grapes here, which is why we had to do something. And as badly as I felt pulling out all those beautiful raspberry bushes, I mean, it was just time. I mean, it was getting out of control, or this entire area would
right.
just be filled.
Right.
So.
And it so much would have gone to waste because we couldn't pick all of those.
Well, you still have your blackberries, though.
Blackberries are still here, and we should get some blackberries off of them. This is the very, very corner, northeast corner of our property. My dad always had peonies. His dad had peonies, and they're just something that we love. So this is a beautiful hedge of, most of these are pink, but I think there's one on the end that is a burgundy, a sweet, dark burgundy color. Doing very well. If it warms up some, they will probably bloom by either the end of this week or next week. Usually they kind of wait until Father's Day, which was always appropriate, but I think they're going to be early. For several years now, we've had a grape arbor that we've been nursing along, trying to figure out how to trim them. Every time we watch a movie and it's in California or France, we look to see how they have trimmed their grapevines to get the most grapes out of the vines. I think we're doing better than we have before because sometimes in the past they've been everywhere and then we haven't gotten very many grapes. Last year we got more than we had the year before, so hopefully this year we'll get more than we had last year. As we were rearranging things last year around the iris, there were some plants that needed moving. I think I moved both that peony away from there and this peony. You can see that daisies have weaved their way into this area. I'm not quite sure what this is. I'm hoping it's something good. We'll be able to tell more when the blossoms come out. This is a wigalia. This was one of our very first wigalias. It wasn't real happy. We had it maybe 6 feet away from here, and it just struggled. It really wasn't happy, but when we moved it over here, suddenly it's happy.
Well, there's a little more shade here too, especially mm-hmm. late in the afternoon.
So maybe it liked the soil better here. Yeah. I don't know. But it's happy now, so we're happy.
Well, that's one of the wonders of a garden, because one microclimate may not be, you know, 2 feet away might be a completely different
that's
microclimate.
Right. Yeah.
Just perfect for that plant. So if a plant is struggling, consider someplace else.
That's right. Don't give up on it. Sometimes you have to, but don't try it until you did something else. Well, this used to be, we had old prickly juniper bushes here for the longest time, and we took them out. We made it so we can make use of this mound. I am trying to reintroduce sunflowers into our yard. We used to have many, many that would come up because we had sunflowers growing, and I would chop the heads off. I'd just put them face down in the ground, kind of scrunch them in and forget about them, and then the next spring we'd get some growing by themselves if the mice didn't get them, or the chipmunks or whatever,
squirrels
or the birds. But there was usually enough for everyone. But because we've had so much mulch the last couple of years, and that's a good thing, we're not complaining, we don't have as many sunflowers. I planted a bunch of them earlier in the year and had to cover them to keep them safe, but a whole lot of them didn't come up.
I think they're bad seeds. I mean, I did order you a lot of different seeds online, but
yeah.
I tell you, I'm kind of disappointed in all the different varieties
right.
that
and
I ordered.
And I did stratify them. I had them in the freezer, so they should have made it for the winter, because otherwise, like I said, in the fall, I would just take the heads off of the ones we had and put them in the ground, and they would grow.
Now, do sunflower seeds need to be stratified?
I did it only because the ones that I have had in the past have spent the winter outside.
Hmm.
So,
do you have to scar the seed at all before you pre-soak it? Or
I did soak some of these, and some of them I didn't. So I don't know, you know, what worked and what didn't. We've got Russian sunflowers, Israeli sunflowers, and then giant sunflowers.
Ooh, a peace accord.
Yes. We'll see. I hope they make it. We're standing on the mound now, and we're looking west. This is our north garden. This is where we have raised beds. We usually do our vegetables here, and Rick has prepped them. We're going to be still adding some peat moss and some compost in them, and then we will be planting within the next 2 weeks.
So how important is amending the soil?
If you don't have good soil, you're not going to have good plants. That's the basis of gardening.
So the secret of a great garden starts with?
The soil, yes. Best thing you can do is add compost. And if you make it yourself, wonderful. If you don't, you can buy it in bags. You can get it at a
truckload
from a nursery. The only thing you want to watch out for now are the jumping worms. There are worms now that they've come up from the south. They're very invasive. They ruin the soil. They take all the nutrients out of the soil, so that what used to be lovely growing material is now like coffee grounds. There's nothing left in it. We've been told that you have to call your Department of Natural Resources if you find them, because they're tracking them as to where they are. collect as many as you can, put them in a plastic bag, let them cook in the sun or freeze them in the freezer, and throw them in your garbage.
But you do have to contact the DNR immediately, because these crazy jumping worms, in fact, just Google crazy jumping worms and watch the videos. They're crazy.
And they can come in mulch. They can come in the plants you buy in the store or get from friends. They don't hatch in this area until the beginning of June. So right now, if there are some in there, they're
now you're about eggs that laying in the soil.
The eggs and the cocoons are in the soil right now. They have not yet hatched. But look at the soil in the pots that you have. If you are afraid or even question it, dump all the soil out and rinse off the roots, and then plant it in soil that you know is not contaminated. But it's a growing problem. They look very much like an earthworm, except they don't have the slimy coat that our earthworms have, and they cannot hold still. They are all over the place.
Like those crazy fish jumping in the Illinois rivers.
Right. So just keep an eye out for them. But so far we've been blessed. We do not have any. This is where our vegetables will go. And oh, look, we have some vegetables just waiting.
Well, let's go down and see what you
yes,
have so far.
Yes, because look at the sky over there. Uh-oh.
Yep.
Our other garden up on the south side is all enclosed. Usually if we plant tomatoes and squash down here, the deer don't bother them that much.
Well, you put them in rings though that have protectors on them, at least while they're young.
Right. So last year we wanted to have a protection over on this side so we could do a crop rotation. And so Rick enclosed this area. Now, you may remember last year, if you watched, we did a square foot garden area where we strung strings, and then we had each square for a different kind of seed that we weren't sure about, or we just wanted to try, or we had a little nursery going so that we could grow the actual plants and then move them where we wanted to. Several of the plants that we planted have returned, which is good. I've got some balloon flowers here that I believe are going to be pink ones. This looks like a phlox, and I'm going to have to consult my chart to see if it is. The bigger clump over there is bee balm. And the tree peonies that we bought from actual
breeders
right. of tree peonies, where they hybridize and get the different colors and types that they want. We have, I think, six of those that made it, six or seven. So we're very thrilled about those. And then over here is kind of a nursery for Montauk daisies and dandelions. Montauk daisies are in the chrysanthemum family. They're the last flower, one of the very last ones to bloom. They are a perfect daisy. They're the white petals with the yellow insides, and they stay blooming until it freezes. They're very strong and sturdy. You can trim them off at most any time of the year, and I used to try to get them to root by putting them in water, and that never seemed to work. And then I thought, well, I'll just give it a try and stick them into the ground without anything else. So I put these stalks in the ground, and lo and behold, that's how you do it. They love to go straight in the ground. So these will all be nice little plants, and we'll have more Montauk daisies. We decided that we were going to have a wide variety of tomatoes this year again.
Heirloom?
We have some heirlooms and we have some hybrids. Our famous hybrid, of course. Oops.
Nope, they're over there.
Our tomato berries, which we have been talking about for years and years. This is a wonderful cherry tomato, sweet, sweet, sweet. Seems to be very crack resistant, and it stays in its cluster on the vine instead of falling off and getting lost in the bottom with the old leaves. These are so good that if you don't eat them all before you get them in the house, you put them in a bowl on the counter and you just end up eating them like candy. As you walk by, you're popping them in your mouth.
They are so, so good.
Truly wonderful. So we have mostly medium size for canning, and the one that I am going to try this year is called the Heinz 1439. But then we also found at the Master Garden sale at this weekend something called the Bloody Butcher, which is similar to the Wisconsin 55s. They mature in 55 days and they have medium-sized fruit. It's kind of meaty, and that's the kind I like to can. So we did that, and we have a couple of varieties of Roma tomatoes that we haven't tried before, one of which supposedly will continue to produce fruit until October. Mm-hmm. People were saying they were picking them in October.
Well, and then, you were lucky to pick up some dinosaur kale before was all sold
out. This is the time. Run over to your garden center if you want dinosaur kale or any kind of kale. It goes fast. We have a variety of hot peppers because we don't particularly care for hot peppers, but we know people who do. We got some eggplants, and this is cute. You have to look at this. This is called Aristotle basil. Now, isn't that the cutest little thing? It looks like a miniature tree, but it smells wonderful. I also got some lemon basil, some cucumbers, and we'll talk more in depth when we start planting them. This is one of our rhubarb beds. We grow a lot of rhubarb. We don't usually eat it either. So those of you who come usually and get rhubarb, come again because it's ready. Look at the size of this leaf. It's amazing.
That leaf is probably 5 times the size of your head.
That's one variety. This is another variety. It's going to seed, which I'm going to break all those off.
That's called bolting.
Yes. And we also planted asparagus in there one year thinking, oh, this would be a nice place. Well, what we found is that the rhubarb is just too busy over here. We're going to move the rhubarb to other places, and we're going to devote this part to asparagus. So that's another little project. And here is another kind of rhubarb. This is called Canadian Red, and you can tell the stalks are red. This is a little less tart than what the other ones are. We also have the benefit of our neighbor's lilac tree or bush. He can't see it anymore. It's behind his pine tree, so we get to enjoy the flowers and the fragrance.
And how about your bird up there?
Oh, and then up in that very top hole above the bat house is a bird that we were trying to identify. It has a call like some bird you'd hear in the jungle, and when we first heard it, we couldn't figure out what bird it was. It turned out to be a flicker. It's a northern flicker. It's a woodpecker. And
how about your app?
We found a website that has the call on it, and when we play it, the mother will stick her beak out like, where are you and why are you making that noise? Another Alberta spruce that was damaged a couple years back by the sun and the wind in the winter. So we again sculpted around it, took off the damaged parts, and it's filling in nicely. It looks so lush right
now. Much better than it was.
Yes. And then last year I put up these little twigs of the plants around the yard for the solitary bees. And while some of them fell out, you know, it's just another place that they can go to and put their eggs. So hopefully it helps. Our original pond has a duck in it. Look at that.
Yeah, right. How about your little rubber
There's
ducky?
There's my little rubber ducky over there. He's the poor
Still
thing.
Resting.
Spent the whole winter out here. These are some of our temporary home for our water lilies.
They're from our former video called Finishing Cleaning the Pond.
Oh, yes. And even though we yanked them out by the roots, I think they probably will still bloom over here while they're temporarily here. We're not quite sure how many we're going to keep yet, but it'll be interesting. This is probably our most...
prolific.
Our prolific and probably the prettiest of the giant fleece plant. It already has flowers starting. This bush will get to be... Seven, eight foot tall. Yes. And if you would have seen it here maybe 2 weeks ago.
I would say it's grown 6 inches since yesterday.
Yeah, probably. I mean, they just grow overnight. You come out and say, oh, where did that come from?
Because this wasn't here a couple of weeks ago.
No. And this is another area where we have a definite grass problem. We have a few... irises, some chrysanthemums, an old tree stump. There used to be a pine tree here. Another place to work on. Oh well. And this is the infamous pond where we took out all of those water lilies and where we're trying to get rid of the cattails that are in here. Our video shows us working on a day when it was actually warm outside. But we have not even bothered this end. They don't even care that we were in here pulling them out. We can see now that we will have to still remove a bunch of roots that are here and over there.
Well, that root mass was about 5 foot by 4 foot, maybe even 4 by 6, 5 by 6.
It was amazing.
Two and a half, 3 feet thick.
Just roots on those water lilies are this big around. They are amazingly tough. I understand now why people don't want them to get loose in a lake, because they would just take over.
And if you don't believe us, take a look at that video. I still remember that huge chunk you dragged out.
Yeah, direct. Yeah, my arms were sore.
Your
my
knees.
Back was sore. My legs were sore from leaning up against the wood. Now we can also see that the lupine have come back. I had these in here for years, and then suddenly, and they never did very well. And then suddenly, a couple years, there was none at all. And all of a sudden, last year, they came back. I don't know where they were hiding, but they came back. And we even have one tiny little baby way over here. How he got over here, I don't know. But there he is. They're very, very lovely. One of my favorite flowers. And then this is a painted daisy that will be blossoming shortly. And underneath this ground cover is a miniature hosta. There's one there and there's one on the other end there. Shall we show them what we pulled out of the pond so far?
Are you sure you want to?
Well, I don't know. There's some there. Now that was all dead stuff. And then there's some here. Those are the old cattails. Then there's this pile.
And where's your root barrel full?
This is a root of the water lilies.
There's another.
There's that
root right here.
Yep. And then somehow there fern got in there. And then there's that wheelbarrow, that cart over there is also full.
It was amazing.
Yes. Our Honeycrisp apples are doing very well. We got them a couple years back, and then one winter the snow was so deep that even though we had them protected, the rabbits were able to eat, they ate the whole top off of the trees. So
we thought we lost them.
Yeah. Last year they started coming back very nicely. They have not yet had blossoms on them. I'm guessing as they mature, they will. We're trying to, again, train them as Espalar, because we need walkway space and we have bushes back here, so we're going flat.
Again, parallel to the lot line.
Yes.
Well, what do you have over here?
Now, over here, these beautiful purple flowers are alliums. They're not the huge big heads. They're kind of a medium head to them, but they do get tall, as you can see. And they're just a delightful color. Just absolutely yummy. I'm surprised I don't see any bees on them, because usually they have bees. Now, we also have a shorter version, that those are behind you, Rick, that have bigger heads, but they're short. Again, those are alliums. Then we have Japanese iris, ferns that decide that they are going to go everywhere. These, again, are daffodils that will need to be trimmed off. We have some tulips that need to be trimmed off, the old blossoms. This is our other Japanese peony. This is a double-headed one.
This is a
one.
Fern peony.
A fern, Japanese fern leaf peony. This is a double head to them, as opposed to the one that we have out in the front that just has a single head. This one gets a little more shade, so it doesn't quite get as full. This is a poppy that seems very happy here. And sedum, and then a clematis that I forgot I had planted there, and then one year I couldn't figure out what in the world was climbing all over everything. Turned out to be a clematis. One of the best things I ever did in my garden, besides planting flowers, is painting this archway. When Rick bought it the first couple of years, it was treated wood and it looked nice. It looked very pleasant. And then as it weathered and became gray and the paper wasps were forever coming here and taking off bits of wood to make their nests, it just got yuckier looking. And I was thinking, well, maybe we should get rid of it. And then, for some reason, either looking in a book or on the web or something, I thought, I'm going to paint it bright red. And that's what we did. And I'm just so happy. I watched it all winter, and it just made me smile every time I saw it.
Now, it wasn't treated lumber. It was cedar.
Oh, okay. Well, the
wasps
like...
But it weathered badly, and...
Yes.
I can see spots where even the paint has kind of fallen off
right now,
so
well, it
needs a second coat.
It needs another coat, but it made me happy all winter. And then, of course, my famous flamingos. These were my dad's. He had them in his front yard, so I had to repaint them flamingo pink.
Have you given them names?
No, I don't think I have.
I know you gave your pink pig a name.
Right.
And he ended up, after everybody contributed an idea for your pink pig,
right.
He ended up being?
Hamlet.
Hamlet. How appropriate.
Thank you. When we say giant bleeding hearts, this is what we mean by giant. This is a really, really happy bleeding heart. Started off as one little twig, and it just kind of takes over. You know, once it's done with all this beauty, it'll just flop down and be done with, and then you can actually see what else is in here. Also, same thing with these forget-me-not ground covers. They are just beautiful this time of year, and then the rest of the year they're just kind of a rosette of green. We are now under our original maple tree that was here when we came. I think it's a red maple. It doesn't get scarlety red, but it's like a reddish green all year round. And in here we have a shaded area, but there's enough sun that I can have lilies in here. Now, these lilies I transplanted in here last year. They were over there next to the pond, but they were all crowded. Why those lilies are not as large and healthy looking as these lilies is beyond me. I can't explain it. They should be getting more sun over on that side than this side, but you know, that's a question of what goes on in your garden. And again, This is a mystery plant. If anybody can help us with this one. Delicate blue, powdery blue with a beautiful yellow pollen. I think it's a bulb.
Yep, there are six of those yellow, I call them almost like a little firecracker explosion, and it seems to be a five-leaf blue flower petal.
Six, I think, actually, isn't it?
I see five on this one.
Okay. But they come up in the spring, they flower, and then they kind of disappear. One of our alliums got away, though. Again, these are the alliums that once they're done blooming and they dry out, you can take a spray can, a spray paint can, and spray it any color you want. And people say, how did you grow that flower? What is that? Is that a flower or is that a work of art?
Well, how many cans of paint do you have this year?
Oh, I think I have over a dozen.
Including?
Including a day glow. So
glow in the dark.
Right. So once it gets dark out and once the flowers are dried, we will be enjoying our works of art.
And?
This is a yarrow. This is the good yarrow. Now there's varieties that are very invasive and then there are varieties that aren't. This is a yellow one. It's been there for a really long time and it hasn't expanded too unruly. Like over here we have blue flag iris. Now again, this is an unusual thing. It's growing in the shade of a tree. It likes to have its feet wet. These grow by marshes sometimes and they'll have a blue flower to them. Again, these are daffodils that need to be trimmed down. Not the leaves, just the heads. Some blueberries that we have not yet gotten planted. Two different kinds of hosta. That's a fragrant hosta. Now, do you see these luscious raspberries? They look so innocent over here. These were the original raspberries that came with the property. This is where we got our original 12 that we moved over to what became the raspberry jungle. Don't be fooled by raspberries. They will spread.
Well, I'm still looking at the raspberry bushes. That was something on my to-do list last fall. Never really got around to it with all of our teaching classes and preparation and PowerPoint. And and then, of course, the weather, when it was nice, try to get out.
But. Well, there's only so much a person can do.
I know.
You don't beat yourself up about it. No. Gardening is supposed to be fun.
And for somebody who's new to gardening, what would you recommend?
Start small. Start with just a couple of bushes. Follow the directions for when to prune them and what to prune so that you'll have the best use of your land.
Or if you're having a vegetable garden, you know, what if you live in an apartment or a condo and you don't have a lot of space?
Then you get plants, and there are more and more of them, for containers. If you get a container big enough, you can grow tomatoes and a pepper and some parsley and some onions, and you have your own salsa garden.
Cool.
We hope you enjoyed part three of our May garden tour. If you did, please give us a thumbs up. We'd really appreciate it. And if you have comments or questions, you'd like to tell us what's going on, what's blooming in your garden right now, what about your successes and maybe failures, please let us know. And if you'd like to join our garden family, just subscribe. Stay tuned for part four of our May garden tour. See you soon.
Connect with us on YouTube.